try it one more time with everybody paying attention. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
It is a wonderful day to be in the house of the Lord. We're glad you're all here. Couple things by way of announcement. If you want to take advantage of doing gifts for the children's home or gift cards, don't wrap the gifts. Just bring something appropriate for a kid school age. They don't have, as a general rule, young kids. So pretty much from kindergarten on up. But they're also encouraging churches that want to give gift cards. So if you want to give a gift card, you can do that, or you can give a donation, and we'll get it sent out to them in time for them to buy gifts for Christmas. But to do that, we need whatever you're going to do by next Sunday. So if you want to make a donation, that's fine. If you want to do gift cards, that's fine. If you want to do a gift, that's fine. We'll get up there to them in whatever type of style you want to do. I try to leave it open to people because some people are like, well, I don't want to give money, or I don't want to give a gift card. So if you want to buy something physical, that's fine. We'll get it up to them. I have made side comments, what I call making noise about Saturday, maybe having, inviting people to come to Fellowship Hall for the church, for the annual conference that will release churches in this go-round, in this final go-round of the United Methodist Church. And found out that we had already scheduled something, an event here, an outside thing, so I can't extend that invitation, but hopefully this week I'll get a link that people can tune in and watch. I think if you go to the Florida Annual Conference website, they'll probably have it on there pretty soon. A link that you can go to. They have to keep a separate link for those who are able to vote and those who want to watch. It'll be a Zoom meeting of the annual conference, and the last couple have taken less than an hour. And that's with a 30-minute run-up to the conference to answer questions for people, and then the actual conference has taken just 15 or 20 minutes. So,
who votes? The delegates to the conference?
Delegates to the annual conference. In our case, it'll be myself and Jeannie Tenfinger will be voting. We're the two voting delegates. She's the lay delegate, I'm the clergy delegate. But we each have a vote when the time comes on Saturday morning at 10 a.m. So nothing else but a prayer for the annual conference and what will transpire then on Saturday. That's next Saturday morning at 10 a.m. 9 a.m.? Check the website. I think I better sit down. It's time for our hymn, All Creatures of Our God and King, number 62.
We're only going to sing verses 1, 4, 5, and 7. 1, 4, 5, and 7.
Thank you.
Our affirmation of faith this morning is number 881 of the Apostles' Creed. Let us unite in this historic confession of our Christian faith.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Lord, thank you for the blessings you pour out upon us. Lord, we have not earned your blessings, and yet we rejoice in them. We give you thanks. Lord, let us not confine our thanks to a day, a year, but make it a daily practice. And throughout a day, may we thank you over and over again. Lord, be with those that are traveling. This is such a busy time. But I thank you for those who have arrived safely at their destination and just pray for their safe return. Be with us in this hour of worship. May we hear your voice through song or silence, scripture, sermon, and the voice of a friend. Thank you, Lord. For all these things I pray today in the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus the Christ, who taught us all to pray together, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
of our offerings. Scripture this morning is from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 9, verses 1 through 19. Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that he found there any who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting," he replied. "Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound but did not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. For 3 days he was blind and did not eat or drink anything. In Damascus there was a disciple named Ananias. The Lord called to him in a vision, "Ananias!" "Yes, Lord," he answered. The Lord told him, "Go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight." "Lord," Ananias answered, "I've heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And he has come here with authority from the chief priests to arrest any who call on your name." But the Lord said to Ananias, "Go. This man is my chosen instrument carry my name before the Gentiles and their kings and before the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. Then Ananias went to the house and entered it. Placing his hands on Saul, he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit." Immediately, something like scales fell away from Paul's eyes, and he could see again. He got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. May God add a blessing to the reading and hearing of God's holy word. I called this morning's sermon "The Other Ananias" because just last week we talked about Ananias who was struck dead. But there's actually a third Ananias in the book of Acts who was a high priest before whom Paul went for his two of his trials. And so Ananias may well have been a fairly common name, but it's not one that you hear children name because of the first Ananias. Nobody wants to name their child that anymore. And so God may have had other choices of who he could have sent to heal Saul if this Ananias had refused. There may have been other Ananiases around that could have still fulfilled the vision that Paul had received, that an Ananias would come and lay hands on him. But in spite of his fears, in spite of his knowledge of who Saul was or who Saul had been up to that point, he went. He was obedient. He went to the home of Judas, another name that you do not hear children name anymore because of Judas Iscariot. But he went to the home and he laid hands on Paul. I can't help but picture cataracts falling off of Paul's face. Something like scales fell from his eyes. We have wonderful technology today that can extend vision for people who are losing their sight with cataracts. It's just amazing to me what they can do. But long, long before they had the technology to do anything, God was at work and able to take those scales from Paul's eyes, and he was able to see again. I almost called this sermon the sermon I never expected to preach, because I was determined that this Sunday was the first Sunday of December. And I was so very certain that it was. Because normally, Thanksgiving is, more often than not, it's always on the fourth Thursday of November. But most years, there are not five Thursdays in November. And this year, there are. And so this is the sermon I didn't expect to preach, but I thought, you know, we've been going through the book of Acts the last few weeks, and rather than leave on a down note, if you will, from last week with Ananias and Sapphira, I thought, well, we'll go to the other Ananias and leave on a more hopeful note. But I can't imagine the amount of courage it took for Ananias to go and take the chance on Paul. Paul could have just as easily gotten up when he was healed and clapped irons on Ananias and thrown him in jail. Probably not an appropriate response to having your sight restored, but you had to wonder, what will happen? What will happen if I am obedient to God? Do you ever ask yourself that question? It's a question all of us should either ask ourselves or simply be obedient to God. I would prefer, I think, if we all were just did the right thing right off every time. But that probably isn't the experience for most of us. We have doubts. We wonder, what will happen if? And as soon as you start asking yourself, what will happen if, you can pile up the negative scenarios very quickly. It's not hard to imagine bad things. In fact, I've heard said over and over, and based on personal experience, 90% of the things we worry about never happen. We spend all this time worrying, oh, what if, what if, what if, what if, you know, and we construct whole scenarios about what will happen if we try to forgive someone, if we try to reach out to someone, if we try to share our faith with someone. We can imagine all these negative scenarios, and they can cripple us. They can just leave us just unable to move, unable to do anything. And I think Ananias, in his discussion with the Lord, was heading down that route. Oh, I've heard about that man, Saul. I've heard about the grief he's given to the saints in Jerusalem. And he has come here with letters from the chief priests authorizing him to arrest any who call on your name. Christians were not yet known as Christians. That name had not yet been assigned to followers of Jesus. They were simply called followers of the way. Maybe from Jesus' words on that last night to his disciples, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And so he had orders to be able to arrest anyone who was a follower of the way. And Ananias, Lord, send somebody else. And he doesn't quite go that far. He might have suggested, I've got a cousin named Ananias. Send him. He makes his case to the Lord, and then he goes and obeys. That's not a bad route for us to take. To make our case to the Lord and then to obey. To obey the nudge that God has given us to fulfill his mission in our lives. To be the Lord's hands and feet in our world. People need to know there is hope. People need to know there is forgiveness. A friend of mine recently suggested that 90% of the mental illness in our country is from people who are unable or unwilling to forgive. That is an unsupported statement. I'm just quoting him because I liked it. I wonder how often our unwillingness to simply be obedient Jesus clearly tells us to forgive if we want to be forgiven. I'm in line. I want to be forgiven. But Lord, you don't know what they've done. You don't know what kind of person they are. You don't know. You don't know. You don't know. But the Lord does know. And he still calls on us to forgive. Ananias went and was obedient. He put his hands on Paul. Ananias even knew what to expect. He had been told about Paul's vision that a man named Ananias would come to him, lay hands on him, and the scales would fall from his eyes, and they did. And yet I suspect Ananias was surprised. We often are, even when we know we're being obedient to what God has called us to do. When it all works out, we're like, wow, that was really cool. That was wonderful. That was exciting. That was exhilarating. We need to follow through and obey to do what Christ is calling us to do. I don't know that any of us will ever have the opportunity to put our hands on someone and have them healed. But if God tells us to, don't hesitate to do it. Because in following through, you may change someone's life. Paul got up and was baptized. And after taking some food, he regained his strength. That's where our story ends. But the story doesn't end there. I am guilty in this part of the story. Our person who needed healing was Saul. But I suspect I've called him Paul about half the time this morning. Saul and Paul were the same person. But Saul of Tarsus was the man who was making threats against followers of the way. Saul of Tarsus was the man who was healed, whose scales fell from his eyes. Something like scales fell from his eyes. Paul was an apostle of Jesus Christ. Same man, transformed. He is still known for a little while in the story as Saul before he takes his Roman name of Paul. It's confusing to us, who most of whom only speak one language. But Saul was his Hebrew name, his Jewish name, if you will. Paul was his Roman name. He would have had both names depending on what group he was moving among at the time. But he goes exclusively as Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ. He never calls himself Saul after that point, when he changes his identity, when he looks to himself now as a follower of the way, no longer his enemy, no longer breathing out threats against the followers of Jesus. Saul was transformed and became Paul. So if I've called him half the time the wrong thing, I apologize. That's the one disadvantage of having the service recorded. People can go back and go, oh, look, he did it wrong there. He did it wrong there. He did it wrong there. It reminds me of that commercial where they want to throw the so thankful that that can't really happen most of the time. But in these days, it can be happening when our services are recorded. Whether we call him Saul or Paul, he was a changed man. And I suspect that Ananias was a changed man as well, because you can believe, and when you have an encounter with Christ that transforms you, or that through you transforms someone else, suddenly it's like, I don't just believe a little bit, I believe all the way. And I hope that's where we are in our journey, or at least where we'll get to one day soon, that we can know that Christ died for us, that Jesus forgave us, and that we are called to forgive others and follow him wherever he leads. Let us pray. Lord, thank you so much for loving us right where we are. Forgive us, Lord, for doubts and fears. Lord, may we just follow and be obedient. May we forgive as we have been forgiven. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, I pray. Amen. Our closing hymn is Rejoice, the Lord is King. Today is Christ the King Sunday, the last Sunday of the Christian year. Next Sunday morning will be New Year's Sunday in the Christian church year. That never goes over real well, but I will say Happy New Year probably next week anyway.
Please stand if you can and run and sing with me.
Keep us all now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.